turn together to the Gospel of John, chapter 6. Let's pause for a moment of prayer. Father, you have set treasure before us, the treasure of yourself contained in your word. Open our eyes, open our minds, open our ears, and open our hearts. Help us respond with love and with faith. Thank you for revealing yourself to us through Yeshua. Amen. Yeshua has been in conversation with many who had been fed by him at the miracle of the 5,000, feeding of the 5,000. And he has revealed amazing things about himself. In verse 40 of John chapter 6, he says, "And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day." And he has repeated this. And it gives us a glimpse into the very heart of God. The heart of God is bent on blessing. The heart of God is bent on giving us life. And that life is in his Son and is available through believing into him. And there is the promise that this life begins the moment we trust Yeshua and goes on forever and will not be hindered at all by passing through the gateway of physical death, because we will be raised at the last day. Now, in verse 41, the Jews, and again we remind ourselves that this is a group probably primarily the religious leaders, unbelieving in their hearts, that the Jews then complained about him because he said, "I am the bread which came down from heaven." And they said, "Is not this Yeshua, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he says, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Now, this sounds a whole lot like people we've seen before in Scripture. It sounds a whole lot like the children of Israel coming out of Egypt. It seemed like every moment when there was a challenge, the way that people responded, many, was to murmur. Whenever there was no water, they said, "Oh, God's brought us out to kill us." When there was no food, "Oh, we're going to starve to death. We should have stayed back in Egypt where we had plenty of food." And on and on. And we're just like that, aren't we? But there is a danger here, because these people were looking at life from merely a human point of view. One of my favorite books of the Bible is Ecclesiastes. And as you read into the Ecclesiastes, you see meaningless, meaningless, all is meaningless, and on it goes. And yet it's so important for us to realize that when it is said that life is meaningless, it's if you only look at it from an earthly point of view. Interlaced through that book and the conclusion of that book is that the most important thing in all of life is to fear God and keep his commandments. And that it is God himself who gives meaning and purpose. So anybody who looks at life merely from a human point of view is going to come up with an inaccurate picture, and a picture of despair, and a picture that is limited only by what can be accomplished by limited human beings. And so there was great danger for these, because they were looking at life only from a human perspective, They looked at Yeshua and they saw a man. They saw his family. And they said, how can he say, I have come down from heaven? But we know, we've seen the whole picture. We saw the beginning of this gospel. We saw John write for us that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Yeshua has existed from all eternity with the Father and the Spirit. And Yeshua has revealed to himself, to these, that he himself is coming down from heaven, and that he is bread that is more than physical bread. Yeshua then answers in verse 43. He says to them, do not murmur among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. And we have considered before that salvation begins with God, that God is the one who planned salvation through Yeshua. And God is the one who is at work, and salvation is impossible without God's initiative in our lives. Now, rather than saying this is a fatalistic point of view, this is glorious good news, because this says to us that God's purposes will not fail and that God's heart is moving out to reveal himself, to draw people to himself. And one of the greatest hopes and encouragements that I find here is that Yeshua is actually talking to these unbelieving Jewish people at this moment. He is actually working to help them see. At this moment, they don't yet see, but he is extending his love to them. And that is such an important realization for us who have loved ones who seem so resistant to the good news. You see, by the very fact that you and I are in their life, that is evidence that the Father is pressing in, is seeking to reveal himself. He has put us next to people, and the very first thing that we are to do is to pray. We are to pray that God would open people's hearts next to us, around us, in our world. That is the Father's love pressing in on us who belong to him, calling out for him to open the eyes of those around us, open the hearts of our loved ones. That is the Father pressing in. And until God says, don't pray for somebody anymore, and there are times where a person can become so resistant, then it is time to stop praying. But until that moment happens, or until they stop breathing, there is hope. Yeshua is sharing himself with these people. He is sharing truth and reality. He is helping them see that they cannot believe unless the Father draws them, that they cannot believe by looking at life merely from a human point of view. And again, he makes the promise that I will raise him up at the last day. The one who is drawn by the Father, who comes to me, whom the Father sent, and the one who believes, I will raise him up at the last day. And in verse 45, it says, it is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. This is what God designed life to be a disciple of God himself, that God is our teacher. This is a picture of the new covenant. This quote is probably from Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 17. Let's turn back there for a moment. Isaiah 54. Verse 13. All your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. This is put in the context of the restored people of Israel, of the people of God, of the messianic age. It is a picture of the new covenant. It is a picture of how life is meant to be, that everyone who belongs to the Lord is taught by Him, that we become the Lord's disciples, and that the result of that is great blessing, great peace. And we could continue to read there, in righteousness you shall be established, you shall be far from oppression, for you shall not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come near you. Indeed, they shall surely assemble, but not because of me. Whoever assembles against you shall fall for your sake. Behold, I have created the blacksmith who blows the coals in the fire, who brings forth an instrument for his work, and I have created the spoiler to destroy. No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue which rises against you in judgment you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord. That is the glorious blessing, the glorious reality of relationship with God, is that He is our teacher. He's teaching us. This very moment, He is teaching us. He has given us the gift of His Spirit. You remember Jeremiah's picture of the new covenant. He says that this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and their sin I will remember no more. The new covenant that God teaches us and writes His law inside of us, not on the stone tablets, but in our very being. And John, at another time in his life, will write in his first letter, But the anointing which you have received from Him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone teach you. But as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things and is true and is not a lie, and just as it is taught you, you will abide in Him. God gives us His Spirit, who teaches us for the rest of our lives, and we learn from God, we'll be learning throughout all eternity. What a glorious reminder to us of the relationship that we have with God through Yeshua, that God Himself is our teacher, and that everyone who has heard and learned from the Father, what does the Father do? He exalts the Son. He says, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to Him. That is what the Father is saying. To say that we know God and to refuse Yeshua can't happen. If we really know the one true living God, we will embrace Yeshua. Back in John chapter 6, verse 46, then Yeshua keeps on going about His relationship with the Father. And He says in verse 46, not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Most assuredly, I say to you, He who believes in me has everlasting life. Who better to tell us about God than Yeshua? Yeshua is saying, I have seen the Father. I have come down from the Father. I have come down from heaven. And I can explain the Father. That's what John has written in the first chapter of this gospel. That he was in the very bosom of the Father. Intimate in his relationship, full in his knowledge. That he shares with us the very heart and life and will and design of the Father. And once again, he who believes in me has everlasting life. This believing is something that happens at a moment in time, and yet it lasts for all eternity. This believing means that you and I can possess eternal life, everlasting life, right now. Every one of us who has received Yeshua, who has believed in him, who has trusted in what he has said about himself and what he said about the Father, every one of us who believe are living everlasting life right now. It is not just length of days, it is quality of the best, the finest, abundant life, Yeshua will call it, later on in this gospel. And again in verse 48, Yeshua says, repeats what he said before, I am the bread of life. I am what you need to live. And when you eat this bread that is me, you will be satisfied forever. Eternal satisfaction. Now, when God says something once, it's good to listen to it. It's important. We need to pay attention. When God says something more than once, really sit up and take notice. He has repeated this. I am the bread of life. How important it is that we see that Yeshua is the most basic thing we need for life. The most basic one we need. The bread of life. An absolute affirmation of who he is. And then Yeshua points out in verse 49, your fathers ate manna in the wilderness. Where are they now? They're dead. That manna, that physical bread, has no impact on their eternal destiny. Physical bread did not help them, even though it came down from heaven. The Father gave it to them in the wilderness to supply their physical need. But those people died. Yeshua says in verse 50, this is the bread which comes down from heaven, that one may eat of it and not die. I am that bread, Yeshua is saying. And Yeshua is doing what he has often does. He's using something physical to speak of spiritual truth and realities. The manna was a type or a picture of Yeshua. Yeshua is the real bread, the true bread that has come down from heaven. The one that when we take him in and believe in him and trust him, he is the one that when we eat, we will not die. We will have everlasting life. Our bodies may pass through that doorway of death, but we will never die. Verse 51, Yeshua says, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. And he's building up the picture. He's the bread of life. He's the living bread. He's the living bread which came down from heaven. This is supernatural stuff. This is God. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. Now, that statement is a statement of incredible mystery. Shaul would write in his first letter to Timothy, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen by angels, preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up in glory. Great is the mystery of godliness, because the mystery of godliness is God become man. Yeshua, the bread of life, coming from heaven to earth and giving us himself, of giving his flesh. He is picturing here, he is speaking here of his pending death, which will be a great sacrifice. I know that there is great stigma around the word cross, but the word cross is simply an execution stake that became an altar, the altar of burnt offering, because on that cross, Yeshua, our great high priest, Yeshua, the Lamb of God, offered his own blood, offered his own flesh. Yeshua crucified is our hope, our life, our glory. You see, the mystery of it is that when Yeshua, the innocent, the perfect, the sinless Lamb of God, offers his life on the cross and is crucified, is hung as a curse on that tree for you and I, the power of that, the natural consequence of that, is that the Father raised him from the dead, because death could not hold him. Because it is impossible for death to hold a righteous, totally perfect, and sinless person in the grave. And Yeshua is the only perfect, righteous person who ever lived, righteous and perfect every minute of every day and every thought, every deed, every moment of his life. And when he offered himself as a sacrifice, as a perfect sacrifice, death could not hold him. The sinless Lamb of God, who is also the Son of God, fully God as well as fully human. Shaul would write in his letter to the Corinthians, his first letter, he says, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, I did not come with excellence of speech or wisdom declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Yeshua Mashiach and him crucified." Shaul, this godly Jewish man who encountered Yeshua, the glorified Yeshua, on the road to Damascus, writing this letter, says that the pinnacle of knowing God, the pinnacle of sharing the testimony of God, is Yeshua crucified. Yeshua giving his flesh that we might have life. And notice, "I shall give this my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world." That's not just Israel. That's not just the Jewish people. That's the whole world. That's exactly what God promised to Abraham, that "I will bless you and you will be a blessing. And through you, through your seed, singular, all nations on the earth will be blessed." We have celebrated Yeshua's sacrifice today. And it is good for us to remember that the bread of life, Yeshua, He is the bread of life because He gave His very flesh. He gave the bread of His body, if you will, as a sacrifice to pay for every wrong thing that we had ever done, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God by faith. Hallelujah for this great Savior. Let's pray together. Father, thank You for sending Yeshua, the bread of life. Thank You for helping us see the grandeur, the majesty, the glory of Yeshua. Oh, thank You for taking His sacrifice on the cross. Thank You that through that You have effected salvation for all who would believe. Oh, praise You for this wonderful gift, this unspeakable gift of Yeshua HaMashiach, in whose name we pray. Amen.